Briefly going to talk about the phenomenology of consciousness, then look at some of the traditional paradigms to explain it and make a case for computationalism, and sketch out an attention-based model of consciousness and see how we can reconcile this with the existing paradigms. What is consciousness? John Locke said that it's basically the awareness of what happens in your mind. Unfortunately, we are not very well aware of what happens in our mind, and most of the things that happen there basically elude our awareness. So it's a perspective that I didn't find that helpful. We can look at consciousness as functionality versus a feeling of what it's like. And so the former, there's a bunch of functionality that is present when I'm in a state that other people would call conscious. There is the existence of a local perceptual space, a scene in which I find myself subjectively embedded. There is access to perceptual content in that scene. There is, beyond that, a current world model that tells me that, for instance, right now I'm in Tuscany. Then there is a directed attention, which can be on cognitive processes or on perceptual phenomena. Then there is the ability to access and follow concepts and episodes and simulations in my mind, and then I can manipulate them. And there is a mental stage in which I can construct hypothetical universes. All this is functionality that seems to be enabled by my conscious activity. But what do I mean by this conscious experience, this elusive feeling of what it's like? If I drop down at the lowest level of my consciousness, subjectively, what I perceive is an elementary sense of a directed awareness. And if I zoom out a little bit, this becomes into the awareness of content. I see surfaces, I perceive objects, they have relevance that is given by this primary sense of relevance. And then I find myself being able to take a step back and then to manipulate the content that I hold in my awareness. But at this point, I'm already one step removed from this phenomenal experience. Subjectively, it feels to me like I have this elusive consciousness light and vial of glass that I carry around in my mind, and I can look at it, but it's indirect, it's one step removed. And when I talk about these things and reason about these things, then consciousness is a far distant memory. It's a myth hidden inside of my mind that I talk to you about right now. So my linguistic content is no longer subject to this phenomenal experience. There are some stretch goals in my consciousness beyond these elementary things. There's the awareness of awareness, the fact that something pays attention and that awareness itself exists. So this makes it reflexive. And then beyond this, there's the awareness of that thing that's on the other side of attention, the self. Then I can look at the self and identify structure and identifications, things that I may trying to regulate, things I identify with. I want to these things to be like that. And over this, I construct my own model of what I am in this world, what I should be and what I want things to be. And I can deconstruct this further and go beyond this. And at some point, I realize that I am not that thing, but there is a thing that authors this inner world. And at this stage, I'm depersonalized. I'm no longer a person. There is a construction of an inner reality, and I can witness myself constructing it. There are a number of traditional paradigms to deal with this phenomenon of explaining consciousness. Idealism, materialist, monism, dualism, panpsychism, illusionism, scientific incompletionism, which is basically the perspective that right now it's incomplete, but if you just continue with the scientific progress, then it'll fall into place, and then mysterianism. So idealism basically is the idea, very colloquially put, that consciousness is not physical and that the symbolic reality that we experience is primary, that we basically live inside of a dream and that dream is dreamt by a mind on a higher plane of existence somehow, and physical reality might emerge within consciousness. Unfortunately, it does not offer any functional models of how this is going to play out. So for some people, they basically treat this like a conspiracy, right? There's no mechanical universe, instead it's something more magical going on. And it does not explain the preconditions for existence of a thing that is conscious. Monist materialism basically says that there's a causally closed lowest layer that is a mechanical or a computational universe, and it can be described in formal models, and we get things in causality as a result of modeling the universe as separate entities that share interfaces, so they can influence each other's evolution. And some version of that assume that matter and energy are primary, but now, today, we usually construct this over information. So matter and energy are particular ways to talk about changes in information in this paradigm. But how can these physical mechanisms explain our phenomenal experience? That appears to be mysterious. Dualism is often associated with Cartesianism, so you have res extensa and res cogitans. Res extensa is basically this three-dimensional space of objects in which things play out, this dynamical space. And now we see that this physical universe is not exactly res extensa. Res extensa is much more similar to my representations of a world in which things play out in my mind. And res cogitans would be my beliefs about this, my intentions, everything that is not mappable on a region in free space. There's a problem of when we take this dualism to be a statement about physical realms or existential realms, that you have a causally closed physical universe in which and a parallel universe of mental events, how is the interaction between them facilitated? Is it possible for the mental domain to influence anything on the physical domain if the physical domain is causally closed? And there's panpsychism. Panpsychism, you get there in several trajectories. One is basically want to say mechanism interaction cannot possibly explain consciousness, but we can explain all the mechanist interaction. So if it does not really emerge over that, it must be before matter. It must be, from the perspective of a scientific investigation, appear inseparable from matter. Another perspective goes the experiential phenomenological route. So basically, when you meditate, you can get to a state where you notice that everything in your mind is conscious, or all contents of your perception, all objects that you interact with, are the result of something like a primordial consciousness. And this might give you an intuition of panpsychism. In this sense, consciousness is inseparable from matter, and you have this trifold separation of a primordial consciousness that exists before physics, then you have on top of that constructive physics, and then on top of the constructive physics, you have the structured individual consciousness. So physical objects are conscious in a different way than their primordial consciousness, because the physical structure is folding this consciousness into a consciousness like ours. Then we have illusionism, which basically says that consciousness does not take actually place somewhere. It's not physical systems cannot be conscious. Consciousness is an illusion. It's the perspective of Keith Frankish and in some way also Dennett's perspective. Then we have mysterianism, which says that if you are a person that is as smart as Noam Chomsky or almost as smart as Noam Chomsky and you spend all your life trying to explain it and you fail, then it cannot be explained. And this is basically the position of Noam Chomsky. And if we think about anything and if something is represented, it needs to be done in a language. And the domain of all languages is called mathematics. And constructive mathematics is the subset of mathematics that can be implemented. This is, I think, the most important discovery in the philosophy of mathematics in the last century. Your perspective on this might differ, but to me, it's really the most significant thing after basically developing a code library in mathematics for several hundred years. Mathematicians have discovered that there are difficulties in this code library, and this Cantor, for instance, and then Hilbert asked mathematicians to fix this. And then Kurt Gödel looked at this and said, unfortunately, it cannot really be fixed. We cannot build a machine in mathematics that can run all of mathematics without breaking. And he called this Unentscheidbarkeit. And Gödel also worked on this, and he found a different perspective on this. And so the problem is that if you take this timeless nature of mathematics as it's classically defined, the semantics of mathematics in which it doesn't matter how many steps a proof takes, this falls apart when this proof takes infinitely many steps. And this meant that the classical mathematics could not be salvaged. A lot of philosophers of mind took Gödel's incompleteness theory backwards. They thought that means that mathematics is impotent at explaining reality, and instead we need more vague languages that are being wielded by these philosophers without formal education, which would give them an edge against these poor mathematicians which would fail at dealing with reality. But I think it's the other way around. What Gödel and Turing could show us that mathematics was ill-defined, and there's a subset of mathematics which works with this constructive mathematics. And constructive mathematics is computation. And then the next thing that Turing discovered is that all these computational systems can be explained with a Turing machine or with a similar system. There are many automata which have the same power. And then after he had discovered this, he thought maybe we are in that class. So we are some class of automata that is able to perform these computations that allow us to make sense of the world. And so he was one of the fathers of my own field of artificial intelligence. We can take this computationalist perspective and then take the traditional non-computational perspectives, or not completely computational perspectives, like the geometry that you have a continuous hypercomputation, and explain this as functions. So for instance, pi is not a value in a computational perspective, it's a function. It's a function that you can plug into your local sun and it will give you new digits until the sun burns out and then you are done. But you will never have any computation that relies on knowing the last digit of pi. Quantum computation basically assumes that the particle universe is very inefficiently implemented on a substrate universe. So if we can get access to the substrate somehow, we can perform computations using this underlying substrate that are, from our perspective in the classical universe, more than polynomially faster. The perspective that there could be closed time-like loops where you basically incorporate next week's lotteries numbers in today's computations, that's possible if you would take our present universe, you make a copy of this, you run the rest of the computation to next week, and then you take that result and merge it back into the present state. So you could basically get to time-like loops with caching. Dualism basically means some preemptive multitasking. You could have two realms, you stop this realm, you perform something on the mental realm, you go back to this one. Panpsychism means that consciousness is generated in a parent universe. I'm not saying that that all these perspectives make a lot of sense, but you can express them in some sense all in the computational paradigm if you really want to. So artificial intelligence is a computationalist philosophy of mind. And consciousness, I think, is a side effect of a particular kind of learning algorithm. Our perception of the world starts with pattern, which can be visual, auditory, tactile, proprioceptive, or emotional, or imaginary, and we merge those into percepts, which cover features of the environment, of our somatosensory environment, or of our own motivation and emotion, or of our other mental events that we are having. And then we can merge all these different modalities into mental simulations, into a perceptual space. And this is what we perceive as reality, and it's made of a model of ourself. And this is, so we have a somatic self, a social self, a personal self, and a current world state, that what we assume the universe around us is currently, and a mental stage, which are imagined states that we don't confuse with the world around us, but that only exist in our mind as memories or imaginations of future universes or alternative situations that we construct. In addition to this, we have generalizations over that. So we generalize our current world state into a map of the world, in the map of the universe, and we have a unified world model above this, this abstract knowledge about everything. And we have an attentional system that also gives rise to an attentional self, something like a conductor of this mental orchestra that produces all these representations. And this attentional system is able to track identities of objects. And if we don't have this, and it's something that we have discovered relatively recently in AI, it's difficult to make certain generalizations. Like in the old days, you had a natural language system that would translate the sentence like, the bat broke a window, as in a different language, that a bat broke the window with a bat. You get rid of this by tracking identity of objects and make sure that you only have one. This is an important feature that you are able to select things. It has other roles too, but this attention needs to be controlled, and to do this, you have basically a controller that is part of your own self model, the thing that you are attending from. And in order to make that happen, you need to have a protocol memory. And that protocol memory, the sequence of events that you attended to, is what you can remember as a past stream of events that you have been aware of. And this enables a biographical memory and a biographical self. So this is what gives unity to your subjective experience, that you are the same being as you you think you were yesterday or a moment before. This enables a particular kind of learning. Our brain is not a layer-by-layer architecture in which you can pipe a training signal through all the layers and hope that all the errors cancel each other out until you get to the right point. Instead, we use a very different mechanism. What we seem to be doing is that we make a decision beforehand for learning where we want to make a change. Imagine you want to get better at tennis, so you decide, today I want to make my uphand slightly more like this, and as a result, I expect to go the ball like that, and eventually I'm going to win the match, hopefully. So you need to store a partial binding state of your brain together with the expected outcome and the change that you're making. And later on, when you win or lose the match, you can recall the situation, you instantiate this partial binding state, and then you apply the reinforcement signal. And as a result, you get better or not. So this interesting learning algorithm requires that you have a model of your own architecture, that you know how you work. And this means that you have to train this attentional system. How you do this? You do this with the attentional system itself. So you will also sometimes store the fact that you attended to something in your attentional system to get better at attending, which makes attention reflexive. If you do this not with a time delay like in tennis, but if you do this on a mental representation, you change the mental representation, you see how the result plays out with this attentional system, you have something that we would call reasoning, which is why reasoning is usually conscious. It's something that where you need to attend and you directly see the changes that you're making to your mental representation and undo them or reinforce them. So basically in this model, we have in our environment and body as the primary model. The reality that we perceive is not the physical world. It's a dream generated by our neocortex, only unlike in the night, it's not dissociated from sensory events. During the day, it's tuned to predict sensory experience. And this reality that I'm immersed in is not the physical world. It's really a dream generated in the neocortex. And my declarative knowledge, the things that I think about, are a secondary model. It's a model of what I'm doing. And this is, for instance, this primary model is often very complicated mathematics. If you see a toddler sitting on the floor and she folds a piece of paper and pushes a pen through it, what this toddler is doing, she is proving theorems about embedded surfaces in the Euclidean space. And these are not trivial theorems, so you have to make an experiment to figure this out. But the toddler has no language to talk about this. And only much later, when you learn some elementary mathematics, you are able to learn a language that is so precise that you can say what experiment you have actually been conducting in that moment. And the self is a model of that thing that is making these models. It's a tertiary model. And the self is, of course, not a physical thing. It is a story that the brain tells itself about a fictional person. So the conductor maintains an attention protocol, which is gives rise to a narrative about the self, and the access to this protocol gets integrated into the protocol. And on the reflection, you remember that you have been conscious. And the remember of having been conscious is necessary and sufficient for consciousness, I think. So I think that this availability of mental simulation to the conductor is the necessary and sufficient condition for access consciousness, and the integration of that access into the accessible protocol is necessary and sufficient for the self-report about awareness. And the self-report about the memory of awareness is being interpreted as the awareness in actuality. And you're not actually aware of things. There is a large time delay between the physical events that cause you to experience something and your actual experience. And it's not a shifted time delay, it's not just that you live in a time-shifted universe, but you have the sense that you act on your stimuli while they're happening. So when I stub my toe and I act on this, I have the impression I do this in actuality, I do this instantaneously, and of course I don't. This is a thing that is constructed after the fact. I really live in this narrative generated in my brain. So we can now bring these things together. The idealism, we live in a dream generated by a mind on a higher plane of existence. Yes, totally. The mind of the higher plane of existence is exists in the skull of a primate in a physical universe. And so we basically now bring these different perspectives together with computationalism, and we notice we've been basically talking about the same thing all along. We just now fixed our ontology. We now know how to point at these things. And I think the confusion disappears. So I think that non-computational conceptions of reality are incoherent because they cannot be properly expressed in a language that is not self-contradictory. If you want to reason about a thing, you need to express it in a language that is not self-contradictory. So you need to have a computational language, constructive mathematics. Physical systems cannot be conscious. Some people think that only physical systems can be conscious and simulations cannot, they have it backward. Physical systems cannot be conscious. The brain is a physical system, cannot do such a thing. But it would be very useful for the brain what it's like to be a person. So it creates the simulation of a conscious being. And we happen to be that simulation, the simulacrum. And it gets access to the language center, and here we are, talking to each other. And we have no access to the physical reality. We cannot escape the dream generated by our monadic brains. And I think that the consciousness that we have, our type of consciousness, is a necessary side effect of attentional learning. And I suspect that machines that don't use this kind of attentional learning will not be conscious in our sense. Thank you.